Come on in. Let's get started for the mining panel. Miners are giving out free bitcoins today. Well, how many do you want to give? Before we start, I want to remind everyone about the code of conduct. Pindar is asking me that if we don't follow it, then you might get kicked out. Okay, so the code of conduct applies to photography. And so for privacy and anonymity reasons, we don't want you to reveal the other participants for this conference. So please be mindful of that. Don't take pictures of other participants either in the foreground or in the background of your photographs. Anyone who's on stage has already given their permission to be public figures. And also applies to please be respectful of each other. Please, you know, don't engage in any arguments or any attacks, verbal abuse, and so on and so forth. Thank you for that. So this afternoon, we're going to start off on our mining panel. Are the videos running? Okay. So Michael Wong's our moderator, right? Okay. Michael, do you want me to introduce everyone quickly, or you want to?
Maybe everyone can introduce themselves. So.
Okay. Well, on the panel, I think we have 6-7 people. We have Michael Wong. We have Marshall Long. We have Yao Yuan, Robin Yao. We have Wu Gong. We have Liu Chun Fu. We have Wang Chun, we have Pan Zibiao, we have San Jing, and we have, do you have Alex?
Yes.
Yeah, Alex is on stage as well. Okay, so go ahead, take it off.
All right, thank you, Bobby. All right, welcome everybody. I think we have a very exciting 90 minutes ahead of us. In this panel, this panel here, I believe, represents maybe 90% of all the hashing powers in the world, so. Yeah. So it's definitely very unique, okay? So I hope you guys will enjoy it, and let us go around and see, just introduce everybody quickly. I'm Michael Wong. I work at BTCC. So next.
Sure, and hi, I'm Sam Cole. I'm working for KNC in Stockholm, Sweden.
I'm Wang Chun from AppTopo.
Marshall Long, Final Hash.
Kevin Pan from Anapu.
Liu Xiangfu, 来自 Aolong Manor.
我是 San Jing, 来自 DigiPhone.
姚远, 来自于 BW, 比音集团旗下的一个平台, bw.com, 谢谢。
Alex Petrov, working for Bitfury.
Hello? Yeah, it's working. Okay, so I think we had a lot of great presentations today, and talking about mining and scaling, and this will obviously be our, you know, main topic here as well. I just want to, you know, like, give everybody a quick chance just to have a quick vote of saying, do we need to increase the block size, yes or no?
Yes. I think Bitcoin will be better for everyone if it's cheaper for everyone to use. Right now, it's about $5 a transaction. That's too high. It simply has to be cheaper.
Okay. So let's just go through.
Yes, yeah, sure. We think the block size should be increased and increased as soon as possible. Obviously, not long enough.
Yeah.
对，我们也认为应该增加，但是不要一下子增加的太大，它对很多系统会有很大的压力。
Yes. Yeah, sure. Okay. I'll just translate pretty quickly. So, he was saying that yes, we do want to increase it, but not too fast because there are resource constraints we need to think about.
Not grow too much.
Not grow too much as well. Yeah. Thank you.
I think we should increase the block size immediately.
我个人认为中国的比特币社区应该和国外的更多的交流来解决这个 block size 的问题。交流最重要。
So, I wish that the Bitcoin community in China have more communication with the Bitcoin community in rest of the world, yeah, to solve this problem.
我个人认为就是无可厚非，中国现在有最大的交易所和矿工。对于扩容这个问题，中国有句古话，欲速则不达。大家的，我觉得这主要是今天这个问题的话，我还不如想打BW 的广告。因为我觉得就是说，这是一个核心开发者的一个问题，解决问题的方式有 ABCD。当然，你选择每一种都可能有缺陷。所以说，太过于激进肯定是不好的，直接会造成比特币的价值的波动。矿工最在乎的是什么？在中国的矿工最重要的就是说投资价值，喜欢这个东西。所以说我觉得扩容是应该循序渐进的一个过程啊，这里面有一些方案我觉得挺不错的啊。谢谢。
I didn't get the whole part. 你再总结一下，我来说一下英文。
我个人觉得就是说中国有一个比特币最大的市场啊，包括交易所和矿池。所以说中国有句古话，欲速则不达，这个问题其实是核心开发者的问题，解决这个问题有很多方案。
So China has a large market for exchanges and mining pool, and the way to solve there are many technical solutions to solve the problem. 有很多方案在了。
对，每一种方案都有优缺点。
Every solution has pros and cons.
所以说，我们应该以维护比特币的稳定为核心的时候，再去尝试不同的方案，多加一些测试在里面。
We should emphasize on the keeping Bitcoin stable, emphasize stability in order to improve the protocol and so on.
对，必须要有测试数据的支撑，而不是说脑洞大开之后直接就。
We should base our decision based on.Test data rather than just making it up on our own.
应该就是核心开发者和社区，无论是中国还是美国，都是以维护比特币价值出现不要出现大的波动为前提去改造这个网络。
So core developers should emphasize on the stability of Bitcoin, both in the protocol technology and also the price stability.
BW 的宗旨就是维护矿工的利益。
Our goal, BW's goal is to emphasize the value for the miners.
对，谢谢。
Thank you. So I'll stand and translate for the Chinese speakers.
下一个。
So the answer is short. Yes, we should increase the block size. This also has three different layers. So first, it's a trust of society. So we should increase it without losing the trust.Secondly, it's also including the economy. And third one, last but not least, so it's technical. Right now, we are not technically ready for increasing the block size. There is a lot of technical issues inside Bitcoin Core, and they should be solved before. Otherwise, if we're increasing block immediately, for example, even for 8 megabytes, this can ruin the system.So, yes, we should increase the block size, but we should do it very, very accurate, step by step, checking all the steps, and it will increase the economy. Thanks.
Okay, great. Thank you, everybody. And I think it's a consensus that everybody wants to increase the block size, but the question is basically how much and how fast, right? So that is my next question. There are two main proposals that we heard today regarding block size increase, BIP 100 and BIP 101. I would like to hear the panel express their views on those two block sizes. Okay?
I guess I'll go first. So we publicly declare our support for both. We think that either of them will increase the block size. Right now, BIP 100 is more in favor for us, so why not vote for it? But we have to actually be honest and say that if we can't get it, BIP 101 is absolutely okay, but both of them need more testing. BIP 100 has an issue with the voting. I don't think it can be as high. Confirmation is 80% and above. That actually gives the power to someone with 20% of the hashing. Anyone with 20% of the hashing can actually stop the block size from increasing. I think that's bad. BIP 101 may not be fast enough. It may be too fast, we simply don't know. It may be a combination of both. I would be in favor of something that combined both of them.
We proposed BIP 100 because BIP 101, someone's pushing it too hard, so we need someone to counterpart. Right now we sit here and rethink this question. We think we need some better solutions because BIP 100 may be too complex, I think it can be better solution for this.
Yeah, so we all got together today and we basically just echoed what these guys said, a combination, something that's not very complex, but also something that doesn't make us look like the evil bad guys that everybody already thinks we are. We're getting very close to what we think everybody could agree on, something that doesn't really make us in a voting power position, but also something that doesn't scale too quickly for infrastructure to catch up to.
我们支持 BIP 100.
We support BIP 100.
101 呢，它是用一个规则来规定未来的增长，空间增长速度。
The reason is they use rules to determine the future growth of Bitcoin block size.
如果实际的增长速度超过这个规则，那么我们很有可能大家再坐在一起来讨论这个事情，然后重新的更改这个规则。
So if the actual needs for block size grows faster than the rules we implement, then we'll get together again to discuss this.
如果实际的增长速度过慢，然后呢又显得会不够用，然后我们还是会重新讨论这个事情。所以我们觉得。
So if the opposite happens, then we can still get together and discuss.
最重要就是BIP 100，我们总是需要矿工们在一起讨论这个事情。
In the end, we support BIP 100 so that the miners can get together and discuss this properly.
我个人认为还是 BIP 100应该能得到中国和西方的比特币社区的同时的认可。
I personally think that BIP 100 will get the support for both China and the rest of the world.
我觉得比特币已经被全球接受了。
I think Bitcoin has already been accepted by the worldwide audience.
我觉得现在我个人认为比特币blockchain size 大小的问题其实已经是比特币和有点类似和中国的GFW 有一点冲突了这样。
I personally think that the Bitcoin blockchain topic has conflicts with the Great Firewall of China.
我认为我们应该就目前来说 BIP 很好，但长远来说我们要找到一个更明智的方法来解决这个中国网络和国外网络的这个问题。
I think the current BIP proposal is good.But down the road, we need a better solution to solve the Great Firewall of China issue.
That's all.
我个人是不支持哪一边的，因为 Bitcoin 是你的，不是你的，也不是我的，而是大家的。Bitcoin 也是代表一个民主，所以说选择是交给大家。
I personally don't want to pick either solution because Bitcoin is not mine, nor is really for everyone to use. So I think we'll leave it up to the people.
我也同意三金的观点和其他人的观点。现在无非就是卡在中国的这个防火墙的一个问题和 支撑快的大小的问题，就是他们我们的 BW 的宗旨就是以客户的这个利益优先。
Okay, I agree with Sanjing and the rest of the panel members. I think in the end, the topic is stuck on the issue relating to the Great Firewall of China, the network bandwidth.
就是我们会 BW 的矿石主要也是以矿工的这个福利为优先，以他们的利益最大化投票权为优先的一个原则啊。
So, our mining pool, we will bring the best features to our mining customers.
Thank you.
So, Bit4 officially more support BIP 100 because
will we not?
Support, yes. Why? Because it's less risky and looking more balanced.About voting, so the minuses was also described before, and on pervert scaling Bitcoin, we also suggest more better voting algorithm, which is more democratic and more balanced. So accept that or doesn't accept, so the society should decide. We just provide the mathematical model. So what about BIP 101? So,Maybe it will be next step. There is a lot of the technical future solution inside it, but because it contains a lot of the technical combinations for new features inside at once, it looks more risky. And we are very skeptical about it. So without any tests,without detailed analysis of each features, so I think it's very risky to accept it.
Okay, thank you everybody. And I think also I just want to give the BTCC view that we are also in support of BIP 100, and we declared that a few months back as well. But I would like to ask the panel, what do you think about the opposition of BIP 100? There are people saying thatBIP 100 is pro-miner and giving the miners too much control. What do you say about this question? I'll ask our Chinese miners. F2 pool.
I think in Bitcoin's world, mining power represents everything. Mining... when I first get to know Bitcoin, I was told mining power is voting right. So mining is Bitcoin, I think. So it's normal, I think. Otherwise, who can vote? Only miners can vote in the system.So if you give the right to user, how can you measure the users? You cannot, this is not a POS system, or, you know, proof of work system, miner is everything. And I would like also to clarify, we do not BIP 100. We think there can be a better solution than BIP 100. If everyone else,support BIP 100. We would like to follow them. But I would like to see a more simple solution and easier to be implemented, free of bugs, and to deploy it as soon as possible. Also, I don't think the Great Firewall in China is a big issue.It's only on the network layer, but the network layer problem can be solved by like a relay network, by optimization, and the bigger problem here is like if we increase block size, we have to face not only network issues, but also CPU, hard disk, many other things.For example, this takes about a few days if you download the new Bitcoin core software to resync with the network. If the block size increased by to 8 megabytes, it doesn't take too much time. We have to wait like 1 month to get the software to start to work. So that's a disaster, I think.
Okay, anybody else want to address the question? The question was really about what do you think or about having, and the main opposition of BIP100 that I know of is that they're giving miners too much voting rights, too much power.
In general, I think everybody says if you want more voting power, then be a bigger miner. I think that's what Wing Chun is basically saying, okay. And he's right. In a proof-of-work system, that's the security model, and those are the people that have the voting rights, and a lot of people don't like that. But we also, again, don't think BIP100 is the perfect solution. Maybe there's a perfect solution where miners aren't doing the voting.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else want to add on it?
So the miners currently have the power. We can not process transactions if we don't want to. And actually, if we keep the block size the same, it gives us more power. Actually, increasing the block size means that there will be other miners out there that have a cheaper cost of running that can take those transactions. If I set my minimum fee to $2 per transaction, who wants to pay it? No one. If I set it mine to free, who wants to do it? Everyone, right? It's already there. The power is actually with us to accept it, but it's with everyone else to send it. If we create more space on our blocks, then we can take more transactions, Bitcoin can grow more. So it actually is the miners are working for the community, not the other way around. We cannot increase the block size. If no one's going to fill it, it's useless. We just want more people to use Bitcoin. That means bigger blocks.
So, I would like to discuss a little bit about the voting. So you're saying the miners are getting too much power for what? But it's like in real world. So you are choosing politics, and they are making decisions instead of you. So you are not sitting each day. You are not thinking about the laws, how to organize the society life. The same in the mining. So core developer team, each day, according, they are spending a lot of time, a lot of resources. They are better understand a lot of ideas. The miners doing absolutely the same. We invest a lot of money, we already take a lot of risk on us. So if something happens with Bitcoin, so we are also losing a lot because we are built big infrastructure. We invest in that infrastructure. We also spend a lot of time. It's not only about the just hours. So it's also engineering forces. It's also human resources. So we are better and deeper in many situations understand the problem, and they're looking also for a future. This is why Bitfury also making a lot of researches. We are looking for a future. We are thinking how to develop it. And they are also interested to develop it, not only just to extract economical pluses and collect the money. So we found the better technology. We think there is a bright future for that technologies. We see the idea under blockchain, under Bitcoin. So this why we are trying to develop it. So we are better believer, I think. So in miners, in most, it's a dreamers. So we believe when no one was thinking about the mining, we already start thinking about the mining because we are believing in the Bitcoin. So this is one of the explanation why we are getting the votes and why we are voting.
Okay, thank you.
就是矿工这个权力过大的问题，我觉得比特币就是由挖矿来驱动的，然后挖矿行业进行自由竞争，它必然会发展成一个矿池的局面。So
regarding this problem, the fundamental of Bitcoin is that miners get to decide this. So there's through miner competition, we hope to solve this problem.
对，只要市场是自由竞争的，它必然会是这样。所以，要做的事情就是，核心开发小组跟大的矿池之间保持良好的沟通，然后 更多的沟通来做一个决定。
So as long as there's free competition amongst the miners and mining pools, then that's how it's going to happen. So I recommend for there to be good communication between the core developers and the mining community so that we can solve this problem together.
我有一点想说的就是，这好比就是之前几年矿机厂商、矿工和矿池都很苦，竞争都非常激烈，天天这么努力的挖矿，支持比特币的发展。突然有一天，好像把这个矿机厂商、矿工和矿池放到了陪审团的位置。
放在什么？
陪审团，陪审团。
Okay, so over the last 2 years, we've seen extreme competition between amongst the miners and the mining hardware manufacturers and the mining pools, and all of a sudden now we're in the elevated position to make this decision to you know, feel guilty, I think.
No. It's like there's a court lawyer. There are a bunch of people decide that this group of people, how to say that in English?
Jury.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, the miners are put onto a pedestal to be the jury of this big decision.
Jury. Yes. It's like suddenly some people in the city put in the seat of the jury. So BIP 100 is like a case. So right now, I think there's no lawyer on both sides. So we need a lawyer. Means that we need more discussion, more evidence, which one is better, which one is bad, things like that. I think that's the miners' position right now. They really don't know what happened. We need more information. Yeah.
So I would like a little bit expound this speech because the guy was using word lawyer, but they are not the lawyers. They are more like a notary. So we are just signing the transactions.
Yeah. Yeah.
But like a notary, so we are also thinking about how to do it better, how to optimize it, how to do it more efficient. So it's a simple thing. But they also the technical person. So if we are talking about the just law, so yeah, the notary is just the guy who understands the law, but they are technical persons. So we should understand a lot of the technical problems. And they know a lot of the things inside the Bitcoin. So we see a lot of things which are still not ready for expansion. So and the block size increase. So for most of the users, you see just the 8 megabytes and it will solve all the problems. So 100 megabytes block it and it will solve everything. From a miner side, it doesn't matter what the amount of a block of transactions we are signing. For us, it's just a hash. Simple functions, doesn't matter how long it is. So we can sign any transactions. So, and technically, just to transfer the block, just to store the block, it's practically base of a Bitcoin network. So if a blockchain will take 500 gigabytes per year, so it will be not so easy to just allocate the wallets, just to fund the transaction, just to verify it. So no, a lot of average user can afford themselves to buy each year new hard drive just to store blockchain. You'll not be able to download it. The system will be just ruined just in days. So this is the main reason why we are saying it should be done step by step. Technically, everything can be solved. Just require the time.
好, thank you. Now, my last question will be in Chinese, so I'll direct it to our Chinese users, Chinese miners here. 我们现在国内是就是最大算力都在国内，对吗？那你们有没有担心会造错那个51%的攻击这个情况
？So I'll repeat the question. So now the big part of the mining community is in China. Are you worried about the 51% attack?
I'm asking our Chinese miners.
我想之前的话，在2014年以前， 最大的算力都是在其实都是在美国了，50%以上。这个时候呢，他们没有制造出这样的攻击来，当然就没有任何理由去推测或者是去怀疑我们去将来会造成类似的这样的事件。
So before 2014, over half of the hashing power was in the United States, and at that time, there was no accusation or worry about the United States engaging in any 51% attack. So I find it weird that you're accusing China of that risk.
这是这我说一下 BW 这边 ，BW 现在是 50P， 占全网大概8%-10%之间。
我们不做广告，好吗？
OK， 就是我说这个事情就是，我们可以生产很多矿机，中国，是有能力占有一个矿池51%。Please。
所以呢？
你先 translation。你 you fire me。
Okay, he's saying anyone can buy hardware to increase mining power.
对
，hash power.
但是大家都知道，上一次即 hash 有51%，现在的结局，所以说在中国，中国人是一个很厚道的一个民族。Please，
你说下去
啊，我怕你记不住。然后这种51%的攻击，其实对于矿工是没有任何含义的。就是对于这个矿工的利益是没有任何利益的，所以说在
yeah, there's no advantage for the miners to engage in the 50, to increase power over 51%.
对，中国人是一般就是和平的，所以说中国的几大矿池都是一个很友好的关系。
So the Chinese people are very harmonious. So we think the mining community in China has a harmonious attitude.
对，
我觉得有那个不用再次不停的强调中国人的友谊之间的什么东西，我觉得这一切都是由利益决定的。
I think that it's not about the Chinese people or what's they're good at heart, but in the end, it's all about economics.
如果说我们发动51%攻击可以有助于我们得到更多的比特币，并且是长远的得到更多的比特币，那我觉得是有可能发生的。
I think that if there's economic benefit to having more than 51% hash power to attack the network, in the long term, if there's beneficial to us, then it would happen.
但如果说我们做了，只要做一次51%的攻击，我们就会失去我们的用户，失去我们的算力，我们将损失很多钱。所以说，从
However, if we do even just once attack with a 51% attack, then we'll lose a lot of credibility, lose a lot of users, and it will overall be bad for the Bitcoin ecosystem.
对，我认为所有的公司都不会去对钱撒谎的，所有的公司都会去赚钱，所以说这是一个不可能发生的事情。
For these reasons, for pure economic reasons, there's no way any company would be dumb enough to engage in that 51% attack.
Okay. Yes, Alex.
So I think right now.It will be also very hard technically to perform 51% attack. And if you are talking about the 51% located in China, so it's still different pools. And extracting the economical benefit from performing 51%, it's not happens just in seconds. So it will take hours, days, and weeks. So I think the result, it may just not cost the money what you're just investing in that operation. But the biggest minus, so everyone should also realize, so if you just compromise that system, we practically just kill the better technology for our future. So no one will trust anymore in the blockchain. It's practically like destroying the electricity. So yes, we can survive without it, but we will just...loose edges of the future. So blockchain, it's a beautiful technology. So Bitcoin, it's just right now leadership of a technology of a blockchains. And it's like a mother of all blockchains. So it's more trusted, it's more conformant. So, and I think all the other blockchains should just be after time logically connected to more trusted source to Bitcoin. It's not perfect, so, but it's improving. And I think this is the better technology what we should just try to develop and take care about it. So performing the attack, yes, economically it can provide benefits, but it doesn't work like I said in seconds. So just to extract the money what people what is investing in the Bitcoin, so it take month, and you will see the first results of if someone just start to perform the 51% attack. I think a lot of the newspapers, a lot of the sources, a lot of the forums, a lot of the exchanges will start scream immediately. It's only how we can choose our reaction, how we will react on that. So and at this side, it can be prepared. So
three things to kind of wrap everybody's thoughts together. Robin said it's if it or Kevin said if there's better long-term gains, then we would have already done it. But the reality is, if we break it now, we don't know what the long-term gains are. Period. That's the first thing. Second thing is, a lot of people think, okay, if you break it, then you have all these miners that you can't use. It's not just miners. Nobody wants to host a web server in a mining data center, ever. You just have a warehouse with 20 megawatts, and you're gonna call Facebook and say, hey, you wanna host web servers here? They're gonna go there and tell you, you know, what is this? So not just miners, but the infrastructure surrounding our operations are impossible to leverage in any other environment. And the third thing being, basically what Alex had to say, there's a lot of companies exploring the technology now. If we break Bitcoin, just imagine the sheer anarchy that's going to take place with all the banks and everybody that's checking out blockchain tech that's not even related to Bitcoin. But when they hear that that's broken, then you know everybody's really cool project that they're working on is basically at that point going to be subsequently, even if it's not really, seen as being broken. So there's a lot of, it just doesn't make sense, period.
我觉得比特币就像在互联网上互联网金融行业的就像是在互联网金融里面发明了电灯泡一样。一旦
I feel that Bitcoin is kind of like a new light bulb that got invented within internet finance.
一旦被点亮之后应该没人会想把它灭掉。
Once the light bulb is lit, then no one would want to turn it off.
Okay, Alex?
One great compare about the Bitcoin. So I think right now we are approximately in the beginning of the internet, so in the 90s. So in the start of the early 90s, no one was thinking what the internet will be in the next 10, 15, 20 years. And Bitcoin approximately the same. So it's a brilliant new technology, providing a lot of possibilities, but they practically doesn't even realize what they can build on top of a blockchain. We are just researching in that direction. But it's definitely the new technology which allows to do a lot of things. It just doesn't realize all the possibilities.
Okay, so what I'm hearing here is that we have a panel here with a lot of responsible mining pool operators and wants really to get Bitcoin to see Bitcoin succeed, right? So I think we are in safe hands. All right, but on a related note, in regard to miner pool centralization, right? So I would like to ask you guys, what do you think about that we only have maybe, was it a handful of big mining pools? Will that be a problem? Sam?
Well, I think there are more pools now than there were a few years ago. So we have less centralization than we've ever had before. It's in major facilities, it's mostly reported to be in one location, but it is still in hundreds or tens of thousands at least actual individual locations that can free to move. So we have not actually received the centralization that most people believe. Most people can no longer mine profitably in their location. It does not mean it's centralized somewhere else. It just means the other people with better economic setups can actually mine. So we're seeing it go to the cheaper energy places in the world. But if there is a bandwidth requirement added on top, it'll just be a combination that it needs to be a cheap place with high enough bandwidth capabilities. The way that mining is going to be working, always will work in the future, it'll be in the most economical way to mine. And right now that appears to be, you know, with the Chinese pool, but it may not always be. It goes in waves.
Before in 2011, DeepBit got to more than 40%, and then we have Ghash IO, and right now we have F2Pro and UnPro both just a little bit over 20%. I think we are right now at the best time in history of Bitcoin decentralization.
I 比较同意王纯的，就是大家觉得矿池好像在变得中心化。其实我们往目光放到前几年，每一年矿池的变化都非常的大。一年之前，大家还觉得 GHIO 是一个超级老大，但结果现在它快消失了。
I agree with Wang Chen. So people think that mining is getting more centralized, but in reality, the marketplace is changing very rapidly over the last few years.Even most recently, people thought that Ghash was very big, and today they're almost gone.
Yeah. 所以说现在矿池的竞争还是比较激烈的，远远不是大家想象的那么中心化。所以说
So the mining pool competition and the competition between miners is actually very fierce. It's not quite as centralized as people fear and think it to be.
所以更多的矿池涌进来的话，只能是他们团队会死掉。竞争的结果不可能有更多的矿池来进来。比如说，我们现在是十家，如果现在扩张到三十家，那必然会有很多的团队会竞争中失败。
So as more people think that as more mining pool competitions come into place, the reality is competition is very fierce. Many of them will die and go away. So it's not. Let's say there's 10 pools operators right now. If another 20 come in to make it 30, the reality is many of them will die away and go away.
所以现在就是一个市场竞争的结果。
This is the result of market competition today.
我想问一下，在座的有多少人怕中国的51%的攻击的？举下手。
I would like to ask in the audience, raise your hand. How many of you are afraid of the 51% attack from China? Please raise your hand. How many?
From the government or from the miners?
你是问是问中国的矿池51%，还是说是政府来攻击51%？
中国的现有的矿工。
From the miners, how many of you are afraid that the mining community and the mining pools in China will issue a 51% attack?
That's not the point. We shouldn't
have to tell the same thing. Yeah, verify. 没有多
少是吧？我觉得他们就是老外、国外的人可能担心的并不是中国的矿池，而担心的是中国的政府。
I think the rest of the world is not necessarily afraid of the Chinese mining pool and mining operators, but rather afraid of the Chinese government.
What?
Yes, he said yes.
Uber 在美国遇到的阻力可能会远远大于他在中国遇到的阻力。
Uber, for example, Uber's regulatory competition or threat in the United States could be much larger than what Uber faces in China.
其实现在中国的算力非常多，是因为取决中国制造的原因。
怎么样制造
？Made in China.
So the reason that there's so much mining power.Hashing power in China is due to the made in China concept, with everything is cheaper.
然后除了中国之外呢，其他的国家都做的是，制造是智能的智，智能的智，就是他们创新非常厉害。
但是
就是说，在中国的土壤，在 Bitcoin 是非常，现在还没有法律条文规定的，其实是更比美国那些土壤更好的。就是我希望中西方文化多交流一下。做出更好的应用来。
No, that's hard to translate. So,
Maybe someone can help me. So I hope that there's better communication and cooperation between the East and the West, and that the success of the Chinese mining, the hashing power, is due to the smart engineering and the manufacturing situation in China. 是不是这样子啊？
我听不懂。
啊，你再说吧，继续吧。
我说完，你翻译完没？
好，
翻译完了是不是？那没人鼓掌啊。我是希望鼓励中西文化多交流，知道吧？
He wants to, I want
会发展得更快。
I want to encourage more collaboration and cooperation between the Eastern and Western cultures.
时间沟通成本是最重要的，非常重要。
Communication is the most important. More understanding of cross cultures. We'll let the moderator decide on time frame. We're about 45 minutes into it.
Yeah, we will definitely have time for questions from audience and also from people, you know, online can ask us questions. So just have Alex comment as well.
Talking about the China and the rest of the world, it's definitely just the competition. It's a technical competition, it's economical competition, so China is developing very, very fast. In just last year, in China was built over 100,000 bridges. It's more than all the whole world was built. And the mining, it's also going very, very fast. The mining, it's absolutely the same like evolution, it's competition. We are just trying to survive. And we are trying to survive and provide you a better price.Because each new miner who are coming on the market, we are battling, trying to optimize our infrastructures to build it more and more efficient. If before we can just install miners everywhere, it was okay. There is a lot of competition about that. Right now, you push us.To be more efficient. You provide more transaction, we should be more efficient. The better way to optimize all the expenses is to build the data centers. Right now, just next logical step. We are building the data centers, but it's not the single data centers. They are also distributed. It's not like a single data center at one point which can just combine 51% and attack everyone.You should also understand to perform 51% attack, it should be organized inside one data center who has 51%. It's approximately the same like attacking the, I don't know, money exchange, Forex. If you would like to attack all whole world, you should be very organized, very synchronized. It's also a big technical problem. On the next step, I think the mining data centers will be just distributed across the globe. Right now, we are also improving our protocols. Right now, we are trying to save on the electricity. Right now, we are trying to implement the different cooling system, immersion system. The next logical step is improving the protocol and optimizing all the expenses in the miners. Maybe next protocol will just provide like a basis.Possibility to install small miners everywhere. Mining machines in the bulbs, mining machines in the heaters, I don't know. Next protocol, I think, will be logically distributed across the world. And, it doesn't mean what they continue to build the big data centers. It will be more optimal just to install marine containers or I don't know.It's just the evolution. It's pushing us, and they are doing just the next step.
Okay, thank you. I think we have heard lots of valuable insight and feedback from our panel here. We are ready for some questions, so if anybody wants to ask some questions.
Okay, raise your hand. There's a lot of questions, I know. Yep. So we'll start over here.
Okay.
中文可以问中文。
那个其实还有第三个选择，因为今天那个早上，我听到他们有人在演讲这个 ITLT 这个算法是吧？就是，不对，是 IBLT 啊。
IBLT
对 ，IBLT 它可以把这个传输的 这个空间从比如从500兆降到，比如说啊，我们要传500兆，那它可以降到20兆。对，我就说第三个选择就可以把这个什么，就是说可以把这个先实施这个 IPLT 这样的算法，然后呢，算法实现了以后，就是你那个，就这个就。如果这个实施了以后，这个 B100 和 B101 都是不成问题，我认为是吧？所以你们觉得这个怎么样？
Okay, the question was, there's actually a third choice, which is the IBLT solution. If we implement this IBLT solution, how does it affect the existing choices?
I was not here, this one, yeah.But I have read from Gavin's blog about IBLT. To my understanding, it requires some modification on the order of transactions. And as I said before, I don't think network propagation is the big issue for this problem. I care more about CPU, hard disk, this kind of problem. I think.It's much more difficult to optimize for this kind of block of verification of this kind of things.
So,
yeah, we have one here still, and then.
We'll hold on, they're still continuing with the answers. Yeah.
So, talking about ABLT, so it's.The next step, what we should also perform, and it should save a lot of memory, a lot of CPU. It should also save bandwidth, and it's a typical problem what they are just facing right now when they are trying to increase block size. So for miners, ABLT, so I think it doesn't change a lot. So they are just getting the synchronized mempool, and they are just signing, like the notary, all the transactions what is in mempool, that's it.
Okay, we have another question in the back.
Hi, Felix. I wanted to ask, also what I get from this panel, basically from the Chinese mining community, is the biggest objective to scaling is that obnoxious great firewall of China. So what about trying to circumvent that? I don't know, maybe transferring blocks by different means than the internet. I don't know, Jeff Garzik wanted to shoot up satellites in the sky or... I mean, there are already TV satellites we could maybe use for broadcasting blocks. Or just talk to the government, maybe get an uncensored line. I don't know.
Sure. So it's only really an issue if less than 50% of the network is inside mainland, right? Because if I'm propagating with all the other nodes and most of the nodes are in China, it's not really an issue. So that's the first thing. You need to figure out how many nodes are in mainland versus not. Additionally, there are express lines that don't touch the firewall.So there's a lot of infrastructure that's maybe not known to Westerners, but it's completely legit, completely legal, that people can tap to get through the firewall. It just depends on how big you are and do you want to spend the time to find those avenues.
即使是比如中国政府现在把所有的网络全部关掉了
Even if Chinese government turns off, cuts off all the internet.
依然是没有任何问题的。我觉得卫星通信的带宽就可以满足现在的算力正常运行。
There still wouldn't be a problem. There still wouldn't be a problem because bandwidth is so low. Even SMS messaging apps can support this.
It's a Weixin satellite.
Weixin. Sorry, I thought it was WeChat. Weixin. He's talking about even satellite can do the broadcast to support the bandwidth for the communication.
我觉得中国现在的网络环境的确是全球收费最高、体验最差，但是。在改变。
So I recognize that today Chinese internet is actually the most expensive and the worst experience.
但是方法有很多，能解决这个问题很多，所以说更多的就是去尝试，有一波这样的人去做一些方案性的一个测试、数据的论证，然后方法的论证。
I trust there's a lot of solution to this problem, and I trust that it's a matter of people working together.And using, you know, making decisions based on real data.
对，谢谢。
We have another question in the back.
Jonathan.
We have one here, and then I can bring it over to you.
Can I use the 普通话？
可以，你问普通话，我来帮你翻译。
因为呢，方便你们了。因为，请问呢，你们可以用什么方法去用透过中国啦，中国里面用什么方法呢去，防止那个51%的攻击会影响那个普通的用户？那些人是拥有那个原件的钱包，可以了。
谢谢。
So the question was,
我刚才说一下吧。那个，
The question was how do you, what solutions can you think of to prevent the 51% attack within China?
Can I fill it up because in order to prevent the effect shown by the 51% attack to the customers with the phone wallet.
What wallet?
Core wallet.
The full node wallet.
Full node.
How about we take that one later?
Next question.
I have a quick question for Wang Chun, and then it's a follow-up to something he said, and then a second question. The first question, when you talk about CPU as being a limiting factor, are you talking about Git block template, or are you talking about something else?
I'm talking about when you find a block, you have to submit the block to some Bitcoin D and verify and accept it,
okay.
And it has to generate the next block template. This takes time.
Okay.
It may take if for a big block at 1 megabyte, it may take. I don't have a SSD, so right now it may take a second. So if increase to like 10 megabytes, I believe it may take. Over. I think at best 2 or 3 seconds maybe.
In my testing, that was 800 milliseconds, by the way.
But in real world, you have to not only just a CPU verification, and you have to write to disk, and you have to, in real world, it's different.
And then the question for the mining panel, everybody agrees that we need better communication between the West and China. The problem is language. How do you propose that we actually solve the problem? How is the question, not whether we should do it.
Learn Chinese.
Sure. So this is a big culture thing. And Chandler has said this a million times. If you want to talk to Chinese miners, get WeChat, first thing. Second thing, core devs know how to talk to miners. I mean, those channels are getting stronger, and events like this really help that. But the reality is a lot of people... learning each other's cultures, I think, is the biggest thing, period. Because once you know how to interface with each other, then there's less cultural misunderstandings and less kind of stupid arguments about, you know, you said this one way and I didn't mean it that way, that kind of stuff. So simply learning each other's cultures, I think, is the number one biggest thing that everybody could do to further better relations.
We have another question over to your right.
我再回答一下刚才那个问题。现在这个快扩容的问题，大家在争论啊。现在给人感觉是中国的矿池造成的。
So the current problem where we're trying to decide how to scale and extend Bitcoin blockchain block size, it's giving the appearance that the problem is caused by the mining community in China.
我觉得是core development 他们造成的。
I actually think it's the problems caused by the core developers have created the problem.
他们是最了解网络的人，他们是最了解比特币系统的人，他们应该拿出一个最靠谱的方案，然后我们矿池会跟着去执行。
The core developers actually understand the network the best. The core developers understand the Bitcoin system the best. So they should be the ones who come up with a solution, and we will all support it.
而不是说他们在那边做一。争论，然后让我们来做选择。
And rather, it should not be the core developers having all the hassle, all the discussions and debates, and asking the miners to vote.
因为他们是最懂的人。
Because in the end, it's because the core developers know the problem the best. Let the core developers solve it.
We have another question over to your right.
Okay. One of the presenters in the morning suggested that Chinese miner may set up their full nodes in outside China. Do you think this is a solution for the Great Firewall issue?
As far as I know, every major pool has a full node outside of China right now.
I think the issue is if all of the mining power has nodes outside of China, that stops all the Chinese people from using Bitcoin. You still need nodes inside and outside. It is worldwide. It is not just the West.
Also, if you see the bitnode.io, you see how many nodes each country have. You see Japan, like even some European countries, Netherlands, have more and more Bitcoin full nodes than China. You wonder why? Because we in China set up nodes outside of China, but business outside of China rarely set up nodes here. So that's the result.
May I just add a couple of words? So just to provide the better analogy, so right now China is like a small harbor. So there is a cycle around it, and it's a great firewall. It just slowed down everything. So normally transaction even doesn't pass like in normal way, so they're going slower. Even if you're installing the full node outside, so it's still slowly going inside. Also inside, so then the Chinese pools signing transaction, the most of a transaction is from China. So if someone sending a lot of a spam transaction in the Europe, in the United States, so I see a lot of the transaction are staying outside Great Firewall. And they are slowly, slowly traveling inside the China. So the problem is they just have a barrier. So it's just the natural barrier between. That's it. And they are just looking for a better solution how to bypass it. Because from the Europe and from the United States, I think they are doing approximately the same, installing the full nodes in the China. They are trying to build the better channels to China just to extract and exchange information in both directions.
I also personally welcome business outside of China. If you want, you can set up your full node over here. So, yeah. And do not try to set up the full node in countries like Singapore, and Japan around here, it doesn't so much problem. If you want, set up in Beijing, Shanghai, it's possible. There may be some limitation from government for setting up a website, but if you just buy a VPS, buy some virtual host, and set up a full node, I think it's possible for you.
Okay. I think in the end, your income comes from the users of Bitcoin, so you must be interested in scaling up the number of users of Bitcoin.
Yes.
So I'm thinking, what do you believe are the advantages that are offered by Bitcoin to users that cannot be offered by more established parties like PayPal?
Isn't that a more generic question? I mean, there's so many thousands of them. Give me a
specifically for I think it's interesting for mining operators to see what your view is on this, because it determines how to make this decision between simply scaling up and maybe a trade-off with other advantages that may be lost.
So. May get the answer. So the answer is pretty simple. So PayPal was before. WebMoney was before. There is a lot of analogical projects, but they are trying right now to implement the blockchain and then Bitcoin, not the otherwise. So it's meaning it's just the next step. So it's the next technical solution what is possible, and it's more efficient. So they are trying to implement the blockchain and Bitcoin right now only because it's working and providing more possibilities. And why we are trying to propagate it, so because we are first believers who was starting the mining. So we are starting from the GPU cards, we are starting from the FPGA, and then we are still believing in that, so and they are building a new infrastructure, we are building ASICs. So we think it's just the better technology. So there is a lot of possibilities hiding. There is a lot of pluses hiding in there. It's faster, it's different, it's more trusted. That's it.
So I have a question about your investments in your infrastructure and how much you invest in connectivity to other miners. So do you, for example, try to build direct links to other miners, or is your focus just on the hardware and like being as energy efficient as possible, or do you think at all about like who should I connect to, how fast, and yeah.
Sure, so right now most people are not doing anything like this because some people are, however, Bitcoin and the propagation stuff it's more about personal relationships, and I'm gonna say building a direct link to Sam in Sweden. You know, if I have an issue, I can just call somebody and then we can figure it out, right? But routing tables and, you know, physical infrastructure from data center, those do happen, but that's a big deal. Some of these are happening from area to area, but on the whole, especially in Asia, physical infrastructure, it's more about, okay, if I have an issue with something, I'm just gonna pick up the phone. So I think Sam might have some different thoughts on that though.
We want to propagate our blocks as fast as possible, absolutely, of course. And we listen and we take everything into consideration to make sure that our full nodes are worldwide and they obviously accept or make as many connections as possible. We need to know about a block even faster than a wallet provider. So yeah, we do invest a lot of time, a lot of effort, making sure we have the least amount of hops between us and anyone else. We certainly don't have any dark fibers, no. That would be too expensive and take too long time. Time is everything. So IP hops, not dark fibers.
Hello, clearly we're all here trying to come to a solution, but in the case of a contentious fork, do you guys have plans? What are each of your reactions to that would be, and how do you see the exchanges interplaying with the miners in that scenario?
So I guess I can take this one. We, as a mining community, none of us have enough power to decide. We will all have to follow the majority. The actual fact is that if there was already something that would have existed that was supported by enough people, we would already have done it. The issue is we need consensus. We need everybody to take part in what's going to happen next. We will just have to all follow. The question is, who's going to take the leap first? We need code to put inside the Bitcoin core. We need actual submissions. We don't have any of our own. We will if we have to, but we're quite far off. But the basic answer is we will have to follow.
Question from IRC. The question was about default policy. So the question was whether or not who here is investing serious time looking at the default policies and the default transaction selection policies that Bitcoin Core does and actively thinking about those and modifying those?
So we have a lot of nodes that follow the default policy to make sure that we understand what the default policy is when it changes. We cannot run our own version of the Bitcoin Core and hope that everyone else is doing the same. We invest a lot of time, a lot of effort when the network is under the spam attacks, trying to make sure that we process the real transactions and not the spam ones. We are trying to be our own spam filter because no one else is doing it. So we tune it as much as possible, but our biggest reward comes from the 25 coins, right? Not the transaction fees. This will change when, you know, 8 years time when the biggest reward is from transaction fees. I would like it to be there now, but it's simply not. We spend most of our time and effort on the 25 coins, not the fees.
So I can even support, they absolutely rely in the most of miners. We absolutely rely on the default settings. So, and how I saw the blocks was signed, so it's typically the default Bitcoin Z. So, and for spamming, they are doing absolutely the same. So if I see in the network where is a lot of spam, gaming spam transactions. We are trying just to filter in, them and take the normal one. Right now, there is no any mechanisms in the Bitcoin D which allow us to do it like on the natural way. So it's require a little bit of attention. So we are trying to do it also using the tools what already existing, but everything is default. They are following the rules and they are supporting rules.
Hello, I'm going to ask a question about the bit of the philosophy of scaling the block size. There's two pools of thought, where one pool suggests that we should go and scale the block size immediately and then allow the technology and the engineering to catch up. And then there's another pool of people that suggest that the block size should go and follow the engineering capability of the network. What is the position of the miners on this?
So there's actually a third one also, and we all kind of talked about this today. So nobody disagrees that difficulty adjustment is a problem, right? So a lot of people complain, okay, why are miners voting? What about where we just let the network kind of do its thing? We do it, let it do it for difficulty right now, so why can't we let it do it for block size? So that the network adjusts itself when it needs to. That's the third solution, and I think you never hear anybody complaining about how the difficulty adjusts and how it adjusts and why it adjusts and all that stuff. So why can't we make block size the same way? That's what I'm going to basically say.
And in fact, my talk tomorrow is on just that, so I hope that you make it to it, Marshall. Yeah, and I was going to give a fact correction as well. Earlier it was said that the only way for Bitcoin to make a to vote on anything is by miner vote weighted by hash power. There are some other things that work as well, such as Bitcoin Days Destroyed. So there are in fact a couple of different options. My comment I want to make though is I'm a little concerned that it seems the tone of this conversation has been about xenophobia and fear that we're scared of the Chinese miners. It couldn't be further from the truth. The t-shirts that were handed out at this event say, "Don't trust, verify." That's the basis of Bitcoin. It's a system where we don't have to have trust in any entity, no matter how good and trustworthy they are. We have no reason to suspect any ill intent of anyone up on stage. But we should want to build systems that we don't have to trust anybody at all. And so this is a very general question, but back to the miners here. How can we have a conversation that's productive about how we can create a system where no one is in a position where they have to be trusted?
So that's a good question. I think everybody will have a thought on this, so maybe everybody would kind of answer this one, but I'm kind of browsing through Reddit here, and the top one is, do you support censorship, right? So here's what I'll say. If you could figure out a way without messing up our economic business model, then we would probably do it. That's all I'm going to say. Do I know how to do that? No. But the nice thing about computer science is we could literally do whatever we want if you could figure out how to do it, right? So anybody says, oh, we can't do it or we don't know how to do it, we don't know how to do it, but we can. It's computer science. We can literally do anything we want. And that's a great thing about Bitcoin. But the key thing is don't mess up our business model, because I'm not going to come to wherever you work and tear it down, right? Don't do that to me. I won't do that to you. We'll be great. That's it.
So there is one thing. So you're saying you shouldn't trust to anyone. So if you're not trusting to anyone, this is a paranoia. So, yeah, it's a normal term, so it's defining. You're not trusting to anyone. So know anyone, know anything. You're not trusting what you even see. So there is a mathematics. So you should trust in something. So you're trusting to another one nodes. You're trusting to mathematical algorithms. So mining, it just work. We are just performing mathematics. So yes, there is some possibilities in the protocol, but protocol and Bitcoin core is developed by society. And if you're living in society, there should be some line. Here you're trusting, and after that line, you're not trusting.
You trust the machine, not the people.
It's once again, it's mathematics.
Yeah,
so
you trust the math, not the machine.
Yeah. You're trusting to a math, not the machine.
So the current top question on Reddit is, assume block space is plentiful, i.e. there's been global consensus to perform some kind of fork which allows us to have nearly unlimited block space. And 30 years down the road, there is no subsidy remaining. Will you guys create a free market out of dust? How will you guys attempt to get paid?
So that will be open to business models. Lots of miners, if there is no longer a coin reward, we have to take all our revenue from transaction fees. If the Bitcoin community want the level of security that we provide now or more, then they'll have to basically pay the same dollar equivalent per month. And that will mean that if there is just pure dust, that block size is infinite, then there'll have to be a cumulative amount of millions of dollars a month just to keep the same security up. If you don't want the same security, don't pay the fee. You'll get less, but it'll work. It literally will be the cumulative amount of dollars that makes the most sense. Nothing else. None of us pay our bills in, you know, anything other than real fiat currency. We will still pay it in the value of fiat currency. The method may be a cryptocurrency coin, I hope Bitcoin, but it will actually still be received on a dollar or a euro or a Chinese yen amount. I would love for the Swedish government to let me pay it in anything other than a Swedish currency. Don't get me wrong.
Tomorrow.
Can you tell them that?
Okay. 刚刚那个问题是，他说如果未来那个区块是没有限制多大，有无限的区块大小，那时候比特币的那个费用也减低很少很少，那时候很多的那些交易都没有费用了，那你们的生意模式怎么改变？他们没有费用的话，我们就不收他们进来了。So if there's no fees for the blocks, then we will not take those transactions.
The nodes don't even replicate them if there's no fees, so we don't even get to see them half the time.
It's even defined in the policy. So then the mempool, so when the transactions for block is constructed, so first, and its rules of Bitcoins, they are taking, so not even they are taking, the Bitcoin Z taking transaction has a higher fee. So it's also calculating the age of the input, it's also calculating the size of the input. And if you have a transaction, it doesn't have fee at all, so just push it out. So there's a limit, 1 megabyte of blocks, so of a mempool. So it's constructing the transaction. First of all, high payable transaction is pushed in. It's pure economy, so it's keeping the business. So the mining is our economy. The Bitcoin, it's also mathematical economy. So if you would like to get the space inside the block, you are paying higher fee. And higher fee. So it's defined by rules, and Bitcoin just following the mathematical rules. It's taking the transaction, higher fee, okay. Lower fee, okay, go out from a block, that's it.
And that's a more of a philosophical question, right? If I ask you, hey, can you give Sam in Sweden, take a flight, give him this $100 for free, you pay for your own flight ticket, and you give Sam $100, you would say, no thanks. If you were trying to get me to do the same thing, I'm going to say no thanks also. So if you're going to include a 0% fee, it's my prerogative. Although many people disagree with this, aka Luke Jr., good friend of mine, he's going to press us free stuff on Allegis all the time. That's his philosophical business model. That's not mine. But I equate it to if I'm asking you to go give somebody else money for me and you don't get any cut of that, and you're going to do that all day, every day, you're going to say no.
Even, for example, the society someday can decide. So we didn't want to pay the higher fee. Okay? We are not getting any in the future. We are not getting any rewards from the block. They doesn't collect an out fee just to cover electrical bills, just to pay for our machines. So there is no reason for us to work. We just live. They have brains, we have engineering powers, we can do everything else to collect the money. So just a business. Right now we are doing work for you, so we are signing the blocks. And yes, they are also extracting some payment. If there is no reason, so okay, the difficulty will be high, and you may try by yourself. You will start from scratch ground, from zero. You can construct your own efficient ASICs. Let's do it. Pay for electricity for free. Process the transaction by yourself. It's pure competition. We are not battling, and they are not like closed society. We are not choosing. You will be a miner. You can construct. Everyone can come, and everyone can do it. Just do it better. So, and talking about the competition between China and Europe, so they all the time they are battling. So it's an engineering power. They are constructing better chips right now. We are constructing better chips. Try yourself.
Good luck.
So early in this panel, one of the questions was pertaining to, well, like BIP 100 versus BIP 101. And some in IRC, including me, felt that it's perhaps unfortunate that we're talking only about block size. And it may be worthwhile to raise awareness of that there are many other proposals. And some of which will be in talks tomorrow, that like actual proposals, most with code, are about solving long-standing issues in other parts of Bitcoin, like malleability, or in UTXO expansion, or the SIGOPS costs in accounting, that may have, in addition to making larger blocks safe, it may have some interesting, I guess, features that the miners may be interested in. You know, like as you know, the reward halving is coming next year, and the miners will be more and more reliant on fees. And like, what if there were a way for users to pay for burstable block sizes, for example? So I'm just encouraging that that the miners and everyone else hear out the proposals through tomorrow and continue the conversations in public. Yeah. So.
Do I have a question?
No, it's not really a question. Okay.
No, yeah.
Just advertising
for tomorrow.
We have
a question over to your right.
No advertisements, please.
Wait. Let me just make a quick translation. So, 他说我们今天是讨论的主要是 BIP 100 跟 BIP 101 对吗？但是其实还有很多其他的方案，可能其他的 BIP 还有其他的技术可以解决扩容的问题。 就是，然后嘛 ，Warren 这边是说我们要可能明天还有更多的那个方案可以，可以了解一下啊，好吧？你们对这就是BIP 100 BIP 101 以外的有没有什么想法？你们觉得有什么好的方案可以就稍微说一下聊一下。Do
we have any more questions?
So no, just no. Really quick, make sure you have a question, number one. Yeah. Number two, may I ask the panelists to try and sort of spread the answers around evenly and to keep it brief, because we have a million questions on Reddit right now. Yeah. So, and we're trying to get to as many as we can in the time period. Thank you.
We have another one over here, quickly.
So quickly, this is a question. I wonder if any of the miners have an added service or another proposal, because what I observe is that you are taking what are the default configurations, what is provided by the core developer, and doesn't seem to develop an initiative, for example, for insight into the mempool or priority mining or whatever techniques. So I'm curious, do you have such a plan?
Actually, I'm more worried about BIP 100, not about miner for vote. It's miner not vote. If right now we have all these miners, they all willing to vote, but maybe tomorrow some of us may not be here. So some for those newcomers, they may not willing to vote. What happens to BIP 100 if no one vote for block size? That's a problem to solve.
Uh, So the next question from Reddit that we're going to take is, how much involvement with Bitcoin core development do Chinese miners have? And has this been an intentional decision, or what goes into that decision, and how do you see that changing in the future?
我翻译一下吧，就是，在问，中国开发员有多少人参与就是比特币核心开发，你们有没有兴趣，还有吗？有没有未来想更深入一点去了解，在合作跟比特币和core devs 合作？
据我了解，国内应该很少，非常非常少。有个别的爱好者业余提交的代码，但代码量应该都在，可能也就几千行的样子啊。
Unfortunately, there's very little involvement from the Chinese developers for the Bitcoin Core. A few people have contributed, but very small amount of code, only in the amount of a few thousand lines of code.
对，然后矿池呢，针对挖矿自己做了一些 Bitcoin D 的补丁，这些应该。可能不是通用的都没有，所以没有提交到社区里面去。
However, for mining pool, we've made a lot of changes, upgrades, and patches to the Bitcoin Core software. However, these are all customized by the different mining pools, so they have not been resubmitted up.
你们有没有愿意想，就是把那个也开源以后
？Do you have any intention to open source those mining pool changes?
如果写的比较好、比较稳定的话，我们很乐意。
So if they're well written and stable, then we're willing to open source that.
So I think each of us already doing some extensions. So because it's not like the very optimal way how a lot of features was built, and the very simple and very good examples. So then you're asking Bitcoin D just to provide the block.Template, so it's answering in HTTPS and JSON. So it's binary data, but it's encoded in base 64. So in result, it's practically 10 times bigger. So do you know how what the approximately amount of the traffic during 24 hours for a mining pool, if it's requesting all the transactions for 1 megabyte block size? So it's hundreds of gigabytes. It's terabytes for a couple of days for a week. So it's just not optimal. So, and you can just optimize and build it better. So, and there is a lot of features like that. So it's pretty simple. And there is a lot of software what they're building around the mining pool, around the Bitcoin. So it's still standard Bitcoin Z. But they are monitoring Bitcoin nodes. We are monitoring their CPU. We are monitoring how their blocks are arriving in the different locations of awards. So we are just filling the space what are right now are not built. So practically, they are various on the first perimeter. So this is why we are trying to build additional features. That's it.
Okay, we have time for four more questions. So. Yeah.
Cool. So, Alex, earlier you were talking about parallels to the early days of the internet, and I think there's actually some great parallels to see. And one of the things that came up is, similar to the block size debate now, there was issues where the routing tables were filling up. The routers actually were running out of memory to carry more routes. And we had a similar problem where it was taking a long time to come to consensus about what to do. And finally, as we reached a crisis point, the people who were the engineers that had kind of their fingers on the keyboard of the routers decided what change we had to make and implemented it to protect the stability of the network, even as consensus was still evolving and not yet complete. So my question is, under what conditions would you guys decide to take action in order to protect the network, even if consensus had not yet fully evolved?
So, The solution in real life, they sometimes happen not in the optimal way, so they are happens on the fastest way, or in more economical efficient way. For example, I'm providing the analogy about the internet, so I can take the another one analogy. So then the network, just normal Ethernet was developing. There was a lot of very efficient technologies like a docking ring, like VG and Elan, which providing to you to transfer packets without collision, much faster, much efficient. But economically, there was built in the China small chips like for Ethernet. It's collision network. It's keeping in mind there is a lot of noise, a lot of traffic. Then you're sending packet, it doesn't even confirm it. But it was cheaper. And all the society buy a lot of that cards. So we are not using the general, but it's faster. We are not using the token ring because it's safe, faster, and provide a lot of possibilities. So just more economical way. The same for miners. If you can solve any problem on the fast hand, much faster, much more efficient, so we are just doing that.
Okay.
It's survival.
You. All right. Okay, next question.
So next question from Reddit. What do the miners on the panel think about non-bandwidth methods of scaling Bitcoin, such as payment channels, Lightning, zero confirmation transactions? And have you guys spent serious time investigating and thinking about these proposals?
就是你们对那个没有对网络的那个问题，就是其他的方案 Lightning Network 啊这方面的技术有没有考虑过？
We are
so focused on, still mainly focused on Bitcoin, so we're not engaged in any solution that doesn't involve the Bitcoin blockchain.
So, like Bitfury, I cannot answer the same. So, like I say, they're performing a lot of researches, and they are also publishing all the analysis and all the researches. You can check on our website, so there is separate folders, so-called separate menu called research. You can find all the papers about the block size increase, just the pure mathematics simulation and calculation. What it will require from end node. They also have analysis about the Lightning, about the side chains, so we are analyzing everything, but the decision not only on our side, so it's on your side. So we are still, like the notary, they are signing the blocks, but you, like a society, like the users of Bitcoin, you can choose and you can do everything.
Okay, one serious question. Who personally have more than one pet hash on this desk? Who personally have one?
Mean, do you mean me or my company?
No, you.
No, of course not.
Who personally has more than one pet hash in hashing power?
Yeah. Who personally has more than one pet hash in your hand?
That's a tax dodge in Sweden, and no, of course not.
Please tell me who personally have more than 10 petahash in this world.
So, the way we operate in Sweden, it's a company. So the company has a lot more. It's not me. I don't run.
Yeah, this is a big problem. Why? It's a big problem. They have a two way in here. One way is a Bitfury, KNC, another company with 21, all raising a lot of money from venture capital, using the dollar to make a Bitcoin, right? Second is raising a lot of Bitcoin from the Chinese community or around the world, raising Bitcoin to make block, to make Bitcoin, right? The two way. The big problem is here. My question is, here, a lot of the mining pool, top five mining pool in here, right? But they personally don't have a petahash, hashing power. They just own the mining pool, right? So problem is, sometimes you're lucky, you're not lucky. When you're lucky, you get more block, right? When you're not lucky, you're not more block. The question is, can you top five in the mining pool share lucky together? Do a one pool, and the real boss join your lucky. That's all.
Okay, so the network is 100% lucky. That's the answer.
Yeah, that's so 100% lucky.
Yeah, so all of us together are 100% lucky.
Yeah,
yes.
And for a miner, just join this lucky store, PPS. Don't need to worry about you're not lucky or lucky.
Okay,
is that possible or not?
Okay, so that, yes, technically possible. That means one pool, worldwide, one pool. Yeah. Silly, doesn't work.
I will try.
That was the last question.
Yep. I will try to answer shortly. So right now we are like miners. We are representing the banks. So do you know someone who are bringing their own money? So I don't think so. You're asking, did they own the money in the bank? No, we are just processing your money. So they are keeping the accountants. So if you trust us, we are working. If a bank losing the trust, they are not working. The same about miners. We are processing transaction and they are just signing them. So you're asking about one petahash. So right now it's not possible anymore to hide one petahash in under your working desk. It's not possible even to keep one petahash in the garage. So sorry, it's a different size. Maybe on the next stage, then the petahash became so small like it was one gigahash 1 year ago or 2 years ago. So it will be possible to just install the bulb on your desk and you can say, wow, one petahash bulb was just mining for me. But the speed of a network will be terahashes, so gigahashes. I don't know, so it will grow up all the time. So the mining right now and owning the power, so it's require the optimization. This is why we are building the big data centers. But they are providing also end user products. So you can still buy the miner, you can still use the pool. The biggest the biggest pools is Antmine pool, I think. So who are still getting a lot of the power from the end users.
Thank you, Alex.
They're just providing the mining pool. So people still can be able to use their miners.
Yeah. Yes, thank you everybody. I know that this is very interesting discussion and I hope we can continue afterwards as well, but we have run out of time. So I would like to thank the panel and give them a big round of applause.
All right, 15 minute break.
Actually, we can do a 20-minute break. So
20-minute break.
We've got a little time built into the schedule, so come back at 5 p.m., and then we'll start the works in progress.
Thank you so much.
Ask your miners for your free Bitcoin.
Mailing list with translators. I emailed before. That's a problem. They went to a